My name is Mehdi Hasan. It's a pleasure, privilege to be here at the NIAC Leadership Conference with this great panel who are going to unleash their wisdom and insights and humor on all of you. I want to begin by asking you all, just before we go, just to set the scene, to picture a scene in your mind's eye. It's 2018. President Donald J. Trump is celebrating his second year in the White House, which is now painted gold, so it's the Gold House. Sarah Palin is Secretary of Education. Mike Tyson is Attorney General. And the guests arrive and they see Trump in the corner whispering with his Vice President, Mr. Pence. And one of the guests walks over. He says, what are you guys whispering about? It's your party. What are you doing? And Trump says, we're planning World War III. And the guest says, World War III? Well, that sounds amazing. That sounds interesting. What does that involve? He says, we're going to build some camps. We're going to round up all 3.3 million Muslim Americans and one dentist. The guy says, one dentist? Why would you round up one dentist? And Trump smiles, looks at Pence. He says, I told you nobody would ask about the Muslims. So that's the situation we're in. And we laugh and chuckle. And yet a few months ago on Fox News, key Trump ally Newt Gingrich said that, I quote, we should test every person here who's of a Muslim background, and if they believe in Sharia, they should be deported. Deported. For the first time, Muslim Americans started telling their kids there's a test you need to fail. But that is the year we live in now. Deportations are publicly floated. This is the year we've had. And a man who bizarrely claims that Islam hates us, who falsely claimed that Muslims in New Jersey were celebrating on 9/11, who scarily claims to want to ban all of the world's Muslims from entering the United States, is now the presidential candidate for the party of Lincoln, and basically three television debates all that stand between him and the Oval Office. That is the year we've had on the Republican side with the likes of Trump and Gingrich and Carson and Cruz and Rubio all falling over one another to see who can make the most bigoted remarks. It hasn't been great on the Democratic side either, I have to say. Some of you may remember the story, it didn't get much attention, but Senator Harry Reid, a minority leader, telling a Muslim candidate in Nevada to pull out of a congressional race because he's Muslim and therefore can't win. Some of you may have watched the Democratic National Convention and seen former President Bill Clinton say, and I quote, if you're a Muslim and you love America and freedom, and if you hate terror, stay here and help us win and make a future together. We want you. Muslims, in his eyes, seeming to be a foreign entity separate from the us and the we, and only being allowed to stay here if we love America and hate terror. So there's a lot to talk about today, and we're not just talking about rampant Islamophobia in the US. I also, obviously, given the setting, given the title, given the panelists, let's also talk about Iranians and Iranian Americans and Iran and quote-unquote Iranophobia. Is there such a thing? Is it my imagination? Maz can tell us when we get to the debate. Is it my imagination or more of the baddies in Hollywood morphing from Arab to Iranian? Am I imagining that? On Thursday night, how many of you saw Designated Survivor? Sorry, I'm a Kiefer Sutherland fan, I apologize. On ABC, and saw that the new president's first job, guy becomes president accidentally. What's the first thing he has to do? He has to call in the Iranian ambassador into the Oval Office and berate him on primetime TV. That's a key to being the US president. You, of course, had Lindsey Graham, Republican senator, saying that Iranians are all liars because he knows that because he played pool as a child, apparently. And that's where he got that insight from. Leon Panetta, Obama's defense secretary, says you can't trust Iranians. So rhetoric on all sides, popular culture, politics, it's all around us. And so we're going to talk about that today. We're going to talk about what can be done, that great multi-million dollar question. Let me introduce our panelists without any further ado in no particular order. Negin Farsad is a comedian, writer, director, actress. She was named one of the 10 feminist comedians you should be paying attention to, one of the 50 funniest women. She made a documentary called The Muslims Are Coming, was commissioned by Queen Rania of Jordan to make YouTube films to combat Middle East stereotypes, and author of the new book, How to Make White People Laugh, a memoir about growing up as an Iranian-American post 9/11. Cyrus Habib is a politician, lawyer, professor, currently a candidate for lieutenant governor in Washington state. He tells me just now. He told me.
I think those are all Washington state voters.
Yeah. So that's great. They're not. He told me a moment ago that he beat 10 candidates to get that nomination. So there's one thing he already has in common with Donald Trump. Cyrus is one of the 49 members of the Washington State Senate. He is one of the top-ranking Democrats. He made history by being the first and only Iranian-American elected to a state office in the U.S., and back in his days as a university undergraduate, he worked in the New York office of a certain Senator Hillary Clinton. Maz Jobrani is a stand-up comedian, actor, appeared in numerous movies and TV shows from 24 to Curb Your Enthusiasm. He's been nicknamed the Persian Pink Panther. What a name. He's the author of the book, I'm Not a Terrorist, But I've Played One on TV, haven't we all? And most recently has co-written and stars in Jimmy Vestwood, a feature-length comedy about an Iranian who wins a green card to come and live in the US. And Rula Jebreal. Last but certainly not least, Rula Jebreal is an award-winning journalist, foreign policy analyst. She was the first foreign anchor in the history of television news in Italy, went on to host multiple talk shows in that country. She moved to the US, became a commentator and a journalist here. She famously called out MSNBC's pro-Israel bias live on MSNBC. And she's best known for her first and autobiographical novel, Miral, about a young Palestinian girl coming of age during the first Intifada, now translated, I think, into 15 languages, more than 2 million copies sold, and of course, a movie, hugely successful movie of the same name. Ladies and gentlemen, your panel. We're going to get going. I'm going to ask a question to all of you to kick it off. When you look at the lie of the land in the United States right now, how worried are you personally by quote-unquote Islamophobia, anti-Muslim bigotry, whatever you want to call it? Negin.
Oh, so wait, what?
How worried are you personally? Not very, apparently. No, how worried are you personally when you look at the stuff that's being said,
yeah,
when you look at the policies being proposed, when the climate,
yeah,
how worried are you?
I'm a little worried. And I'm a lot worried. So here's something I did recently to kind of show you the extent of my concern. You know, Donald Trump talked about banning Muslims and putting them on a registry or whatever. So I went out onto the streets of New York with MoveOn.org and conducted what I called the bacon test. So I basically asked people, are you Muslim? And they would say no. And I would say, prove it. And then they'd have to eat from this cold pile of bacon. And then if they didn't eat from the bacon, then they would have to sign a Muslim registry. And of course, some Jewish people were like, oh, well, like, we're Jewish, so like, I don't eat bacon anyway. And I'll be like, but today you're Muslim, because that's how the bacon test works. And so what I've been trying to do in, you know, recent months is really like test Donald Trump's you know, policies to their logical extreme, and really to ask ourselves, you know, do we even have that kind of money to purchase the bacon necessary to do a bacon test at that scale, you know? I'm quite concerned, and these are some of the ways that I'm trying to share that.
The bacon test, I mean, we laugh, but it's probably being written down on a memo somewhere at RNCHQ. Cyrus.
That gives new meaning to the term pork barrel spending in Washington, D.C.
Boom.
But, you know,
that, right.
And actually, but in seriousness, you know, during the Spanish Inquisition, that's exactly what they would do, and not in a satirical way, which is why Spanish cuisine has so much pork in it compared to other European cuisines, because it was a way of, you know, of people proving that they were Catholic and that they shouldn't be subject to the Inquisition during that time. You know, I'm mostly worried, because one of the things I've been thinking a lot about is how is this different than the period right after 9/11? Because I lived in New York during 9/11, and I remember thinking, oh great, you know, now we're all targeted, and many people were targeted. It feels different to me now, and I think in large part because we're seeing the kind of these homegrown attacks or these things that are an incredibly small percentage of the violent attacks that take place in the United States. Just last night, in my home state of Washington, as I was taking off to come here, there was a shooter who killed 4 people in a mall in Burlington, Washington, and I believe may still be at large. You know, and so the attack in Chelsea that didn't kill anybody in New York City will get way more media attention, obviously. It's things like that, it's episodes like that happen a few times a year that I think put And the way the media portrays it and the way Republican politicians and others will talk about it, that puts people at risk. Because 9/11 was larger than life, but this is the kind of thing that people will start to feel could happen just in their own backyard. And I think that creates a day-to-day sense of hostility and fear.
Rula.
If I may, the thing that scares me the most is the level of how divided this country is becoming. And the division started, I would say, with 9/11, but it started in 1994 with the Gingrich Revolution, where he decided that they want power at any cost and they will lose whatever it takes. That means delegitimizing a president. That means using words like incompetent, traitor, foreigner. And who is foreigner and who's traitor? It started like this. And if you think from that moment till today, the man that was a reality star TV basically led the most racist movement called the birther and now became the nominee. All of us are the others. The biggest lie in the media was after 9/11, that cover of Newsweek, why they hate us. Who are they? The 1.5 billion Muslims? All the people who don't look like us or don't sound like us or dress differently or eat differently? Who are they? They will become every critic, every analyst, every journalist, everybody that challenged, and we've seen it. We've seen it coming. It will become the Mexican judge. It will become the woman who challenges him. So we are all targeted, and we will be all targeted. And if you think we will be somehow spared because you're not practicing, it doesn't matter. In the eyes of these people, you're all foreigners, all. Listen, remember last week that huge thing that Trump Jr. put on his Twitter about the Skittles. Do you remember that? It's basically, what was he insinuating? Yeah, you have a ball of them. Even if two are a danger, they're all a danger. So everybody become a national security threat. Every one of them. It's not even about number, the immigration. It's post-facts and post-numbers. Even one of them. So with them, it becomes immigrants, African-Americans, Palestinian-Americans, Iranian-Americans, whether we like it or not, all of them will become the people who challenge somehow the demographics are on our favor in this country. And these people will weaponize fear and will use it and will whip it. And sadly, our media has failed spectacularly to holding some of these guys to the truth. Somehow, they basically abrogated their responsibility on challenging these racist things from day one after 9/11. I think, you know, when you travel like myself in the Middle East, I covered the Iraq War, 2006, the Lebanese War, covered so many places. I remember walking in Iraq, and one of the people who I met, he said, you know, they basically attacked us because we're Muslims. We had nothing to do with Al-Qaeda, whatever. But it was the simple ideas. How did they justify that war? The justification, the fact that the overwhelming majority of the American people, including the media, conceded on that, it was based on a total lie. The weapons of mass destruction, whatever, that was the least lie. The real lie started when they start saying them and us and dividing the world along ethnic and religious lines, and this is where Trump was empowered and emboldened. The Frankenstein monster that was enabled that is here. Even if he doesn't win, even if Hillary wins the next day, his legacy is here to stay, and we will have to reorganize and do something about it because they're not going anywhere, and they will fight us, whether he's in power or he's on the opposition.
Okay. Maz.
I agree. First of all, the extreme vetting that he wants to do is comical. I know a lot of people here probably had to take the citizenship test to become citizens. And it's the silliest thing because there's a form and then it says, are you or have you ever been a member of the Communist Party? And you just go, no. And then are you or have you ever been a member of the Fascist Party? You know, and so I don't know how he's going to do extreme vetting. I don't know if that, you know, I don't know how, you know, again, if are you a member of ISIS? Like, no, you know. And then they said the only Muslims, we're going to ban Muslims, but the Christians can come in. So then that means you wear a cross and you're like, I'm Christian. And they go, okay, come on in. So it's a lot of what seems ridiculous. You know, I know all of us, we watch it sometimes, and I'm just shaking my head going like, what is he talking about? There's no way to actually implement the plans. And then what Rula just said is very important to me as well, is that I often talk about, look, I'm Iranian, I was born in Iran, but I'm not that religious. And the reason I say I'm not that religious is because I don't want to misrepresent anybody and say I'm Muslim, and then you go, well, I saw you have a drink last night. I go, okay. And then, well, and you had bacon. Okay. And you don't pray. I don't. And you don't fast. I don't. So I don't want to misrepresent, but I do have close relatives that are Muslims. I have friends that are Muslims. I definitely have stood as a face for representing Muslims, and I continue to. And there's multiple reasons. You know, sometimes I'll post something on my Facebook page, and inevitably there's one Iranian down there. Why are you defending the Arabs? We're not Arabs. We are this, we are that. I'm like, listen, bro, I hear you loud and clear. But exactly what you guys just said, we're all being categorized in that category. It's one thing to correct somebody and go, listen, Iranians aren't Arabs. We speak Persian. It's a different language. It's correct them. But to try to distance yourself, thinking that when the shit goes down, that they're not going to include Iranians, you're
delusional.
Yeah.
Can I just add one?
Negin and then Rula.
And this is such an important point that you know you guys both sort of made, which is that like. You know, I've traveled all over the country doing stand-up, and it's, you know, and wherever I've gone, it's not, you know, I remember we went into the deep south, and a lot of people would be like, no, we don't really have a problem with Muslims, but the gays, you know. And so for a while, we thought, oh, let's change the title of our film from The Muslims Are Coming to The Muslims Are Coming, At Least They're Not Gay, you know, to sell more tickets. But here's the thing, you never go to a place and they're like, oh no, like, we love Mexicans, but we hate Muslims. Or like, we think Asians are great, but gay people. Like, it's usually if you hate one group, you hate all of the groups, because bigotry is not very nuanced. You know what I mean? And so, So it's not, it goes beyond the, you know, where we are in terms of like having a pan-Middle Eastern identity, and I think you're absolutely right, let's not separate ourselves from the Arabs, but also let's not separate ourselves from African Americans and from Mexicans and from, you know, because they don't.
Rula.
You know, the weirdest thing when it comes to discrimination, and you see it, and you know, I've been blessed to being born a Palestinian inside Israel. So I happen to be Muslim. My daughter is Catholic. My mother is Copt, and my husband, you know, was Jewish. But it didn't matter when it came to use my voice to criticize policies, whether it's a support for, yes, they have an issue with the Iranians, but the support for the Saudi regime is rampant, even arrived to the veto of the president against 9/11, against, you know, the family of 9/11, because. Basically, these policies will target communities, all of them. And what will happen to communities, for example, what happened in Charlton, the African-American kid that was killed, and then you have a senator who justified the killing, saying, well, yeah, these black people, they hate us because we are white and nice and bright and successful. These are the same logic that will be used to justify the killing of African-Americans or racist legislations like visa waivers against Iranian Americans and against Iranians, against whoever is part of them. Again, it's again the narrative of them versus us. This is what happened in Europe, I would say, under many years, when Muslims who were Europeans and blonde used to live in Bosnia. And if you look at what happened to them, they were secular, they were Europeans, and they saw themselves not as Muslims, as citizens first and foremost. It didn't matter. They rounded them up, rape camps that I visited actually. 50,000 women were raped and released when they were 8 months pregnant. Genocide of all kinds. If you go to Srebrenica, 8,000 men were put there on the wall and shot. So if you think this is far and this is Europe and this, it can happen, because basically white supremacists rebranded itself and became white nationalist. And who are the enemies? All of us in this room and more.
And you know what's a shame, what you were saying? I heard an anecdotal thing. There was a guy, I guess, I just got my mic turned on. I feel like I just woke up. There was a guy, I think he used to go on Conan or something. He was an Indian Sikh in New York, and he did a piece where he had to wear his turban. So he talked about how he would walk down the street and he would have people yelling at him, you know, go home, get out of here, go back to your country. And he said the people that were yelling most at him were blacks and Latinos, which was interesting. So it's interesting to me when a group gets discriminated against, and rather than standing up for those who are now being discriminated against,
kick down.
They want to kick down. And it's a shame, because I honestly feel that's part of, look, I'm very liberal, I'm very, again, try to be supportive of all groups. And that's when, you know, when I hear, sometimes I hear within Iranian, the Iranian community, people speaking badly about Arabs. Or I'll hear an Iranian community, somebody speaking badly about a gay person. Like, I'll bring up the Caitlyn Jenner thing. And I mentioned, I was like, yeah, Caitlyn Jenner. And somebody in the audience, like, obviously very conservative-minded, was like, that's disgusting. And I was like, you know what's disgusting? You're disgusting. The fact that you think like that. Because, you know, this is 21st century America. So we have a choice. We can either go backwards and be closed-minded and try to say, no, we are not part of this group, and let other groups get beaten up thinking they're not going to come after us. Or we can really step up and go, listen, I'm going to try to educate people along the way, do make sure that they know there's a difference, but I'm not going to distance myself and say, you know, just, those guys are bad and we're not.
And just picking up on that point, the points the three of you have made here, let me just ask Cyrus this point, picking up on that. We're joking about extreme vetting and having tests and bacon tests. I mean, the real truth is there aren't going to be any tests. Because as we've discussed, it's very easy to round up people who look or sound different, or, you know, there's not actually going to be a theological test for Muslims, just as there wasn't one in Bosnia with blonde-haired secular Muslims in Bosnia. And what I'm wondering, what I was going to ask you, Cyrus, is what do you do, how do you make that argument, not just in an Iranian-American community, but across communities, as a politician, as someone running for office, when people say to you, you know, I'm not a racist, but, you know, all these Muslim terrorists are coming to kill us, of course we have to do something. How do you get through to them the, you know, the Pastor Nimal argument, the argument that, you know, once you pick on one group, you're going to pick on all groups?
Well, I think two things come to mind. First of all, let's be optimistic for one moment, and I want to just, here's some good news. The good news is, I think out of all the, you know, I don't even know if we can call them scandals or gaffes, but of all the kind of Trumpisms and the times when we've thought, man, he's really gone too far this time, I would say the one target that I think did the most damage to him was when he went after a Muslim. And I think that's meaningful, is that you look at the, I mean, I think it was markedly different to go after a fallen a war hero and his family after the Democratic Convention. Was treated as more distasteful than even going after John McCain, the standard bearer for the Republican Party, former nominee and undeniable hero veteran. That's remarkable to me that even Republican legislators, colleagues of John McCain, were more outraged. John McCain may have been more outraged. So my point is that, you know, I don't think all is lost. I think that. Though I think what that speaks to is a sense to which we are held to a higher standard, right? So if you are a Muslim who, you know, served the country, or maybe are a well-known entertainer or politician, or tech business leader, then, you know, you're one of the good ones, and that there's kind of, you know, you're not given the same kind of benefit of the doubt as other groups. I think kind of, you know, also to Maz's point, I think that, you know, there's also this sense that, like, since we are dealing with certain types of oppression, we need to be squeaky clean and there can't be, like, any homophobes in our community. Just like, and the point is, like, we're just like everyone else, right? There are people who are really, really uneducated and have really, you know, kind of, in my view, backwards views on gender and on sexual orientation and trans issues. But there's also lots of progressives as well. But I think there is a sense in which people think, well, if you're gonna say it, you know, what's good for the goose is good for the gander. You better not ever say anything about any other group, or even one of you shouldn't, because that will speak to the whole group. So I think there's some good news, which is that I don't think there will ever be a time, or there is even right now, it is the case, that Muslims and Middle Eastern Americans will not be respected for our contributions to this country, will not be seen as included or protected or defended. But I think the bad news is, at least for the time being, and maybe for another generation or two, we're gonna have an uphill battle, as other ethnic minorities did for years in the 20th century.
I wish I am that optimistic, and I hate to say that. I was in the UK when Brexit won. A week earlier, a politician was killed in the middle of the street in daylight. She was shot by somebody who actually was pro-Brexit. All the indicators said that the Remain will lose. Sorry, my apologies, will win. 1 o'clock in the morning, I went to bed, Remain was winning. 6 in the morning. People didn't even know. Knowledge is actually really power. This is an ignorant country. We know a lot about the Kardashian, with all due respect to America. I've been working in the media for the last...
I thought you were going to say, with all due respect to the Kardashians.
To the American people.
Let's not knock
and it's not their
Armenian
fault.
Americans,
it's what we fed them. We fed them a culture of entertainment where somebody with an orange hair that looks like an orangutan happened to become the dominant, not only the nominee, that 100% of the Republican Party today is supporting Donald Trump, whether it's even Ted Cruz, who he insulted in all kind of ways. So make no mistake, this is something very serious, and it's here to stay, and will threaten every value. I believe that the American soul is in the heart of the oppressed people, because they struggle so much and strive to uplift and elevate all the right values. But we need to organize much more.
Let me put that point back to Cyrus. Cyrus, you're a politician running for office. You deal with the voters more than any of us in this room. At the end of the day, you're right about Khizr Khan, and the majority of Americans say in polls they back Khizr Khan against Donald Trump. But even after everything he's said and done, not just with regard to Muslims, but to the disabled, to every group you can think of, he still has, what, 40% in the polls right now, 45%? Yeah. He's still going to get millions and millions of votes. That must depress you.
Well, it does depress me, not as much as if you were polling at 50%. But I think there are political scientists and anthropologists who are even now in real time scrambling to try to understand the phenomenon. I think the comparison with Brexit is a good one. But the point about Brexit is while concern about refugees from the war in Syria was a part of the Brexit vote. I lived in England for 3 years, and it's a little out of date for me, but I don't think that concern about Syrian refugees or Muslims coming into Britain was the primary motivator behind Brexit, nor do I think anti-Islamic sentiment's the primary motivator behind Trump supporters. I think there is a technological and globalized economic revolution and change that's going on that is disenfranchising and really hurting blue-collar workers. In this country, we think of them as, blue-collar white men, as a demographic group that has been losing its relative political power. And so that level of anxiety has led to a climate in which Trump can succeed. And I think the kind of the brazen anti-Islamic, anti-Latino statements are part of a signaling to them that, political correctness is part of your oppression. It's part of what's keeping you, blue-collar white men down. This is so not your country anymore that you don't even feel comfortable saying what you want to say. I am going to exercise that power on your behalf. You're going to vicariously live through the things I can get away with saying. And so there is a type of, catharsis that's going on there. I don't believe that 40 to 45%, and the polling shows this, that when you ask even Trump supporters these discreet questions about how Muslim citizens should be treated, they don't agree with the extreme versions of what he's saying.
Cyrus makes a good point real quick, sorry, that if you look at the strategy used, it really is what a bully does, because a bully will point at someone and bully that person and go, that's the problem, let's go get him, let's go kick his ass. A bully will not look internally and go, because usually bullies, they have insecurities. So rather than dealing with their own insecurities, they try to bring people down. And so on a bigger scale, this whole thing of pointing at immigrants and going, that's your problem, that avoids them having to look inside, as Cyrus just said, and think about maybe our society is undertrained for the 21st century. I mean, all you got to do is go to a parking lot. There used to be a guy there who would take your money. Now it's automated. So all that stuff, like instead of hating Mexicans, they should hate iPhones, you know, because that's who's taking the job. iPhones do everything that the 10 of those guys used to do.
But he started his political career with one idea, delegitimizing the first African-American president, saying, listen, he wasn't talking about the economy. Yes, I understand that some people are hurting in this country because of the economic crash of 2008, and I would join to that the failed war on terror. The Trump phenomenon is an indictment of our political class, big time, of the failure to address two major issues, the economic crisis of 2008 and the failed choices post 9/11. However, the Republicans, and especially Donald Trump, started with one idea. It's like, we're hurting economically. The black guy there is a traitor, he's a foreigner, and he's failing us, and that's why you're hurting. The black guy is not only the black guy. It becomes African-Americans, and it becomes the Muslim community, and it becomes the Iranian communities. All of us will become that black guy.
On that note, and as Cyrus already identified, there is a massive argument within political science community and within the media op-ed pages you may have seen recently as to whether the Trump phenomenon is driven more by economic anxiety or by racism, and people take different positions, and I'm sure you can believe it's both. But let me just broaden it out a bit, and let's just, we talk about Islamophobia, we talk about hatred of certain groups. It's not all spontaneous, though, is it? It's not all just kind of people going, oh, there was an attack, who can I blame? Oh, I've lost my job. A lot of it is heavily funded. The Fear Inc. report that the Center for American Progress produced a few years ago identified a vast range of right-wing think tanks who spend a lot of money in this city engendering hatred of certain countries in the Middle East, of certain communities in the US. And you look at some of the people who have, and just to try and segue between two topics, I look at some of those groups who have spent a lot of money on the Islamophobia side of things. They've also spent a lot of money doing things like opposing the Iran deal and lobbying Congress on certain Middle Eastern political issues. There is that overlap, is there not?
Absolutely. Haim Saban sat in this city, I think, a year and a half ago, and he said, yeah, let's bomb Iran, send an atomic bomb. Let's, you know, kick the ass of, sorry, my language, of these,
sorry,
and he called them all kind of things. What you are seeing is concerted effort by multiple groups, and Haim Saban, obviously the bigger funder of Hillary Clinton, but then you have Sheldon Adelson on the other side, right-wing groups who basically will fund, they have think tank dedicated day in and day out to dehumanize, delegitimize, and criminalize all of us. And when I say all of us, we're all in this together. Did you ever ask yourself why none of the networks, none, and I'm saying none, except Al Jazeera that has Mehdi and others, luckily, none have an in-house Muslim voice. None. I was hired, and I'll tell you why I was hired. They wanted the brown woman to speak about this little brown people down there, oh, how they feel sometimes. That's why they hired me. I was hired in 2011 by MSNBC because simply they wanted to talk about the Arab Spring, but they wanted a brown woman, and I so like, how are feeling those brown people in Cairo and in Tunisia and in Syria? That was my role. I was aware of that role. And the fact that I looked like I looked, it was clear from day one that they wanted somebody that looked not too Muslim somehow. The moment I opened my mouth and I criticized policy, I was out of the door. I never came back. Never came back. And I'm happy. But I have powerful, I own it. But there's a lot of powerful people in this room, and I invite you to do one thing. Like every other group, minority group and oppressed group, we need to organize, send emails. You need your voice to be heard. All of us in these networks, send them emails. The Jewish community send emails thousands every day. Please send emails, demand that we have an in-house African-American, Iranian-American, Arab-American, or a Muslim voice that actually speak about facts, about data that he understand, and culture that represent all of us.
Yes.
I was going to say, that's absolutely right. You're right, we do need to organize and get involved, and these are people that are organized, and hopefully we'll send those emails. The Daily Show is the one it's a satire show, but they have Hasan Minhaj, and
they
had Asif Manvi before, which is, it's interesting that a satire show has to do that.
And in fact, studies show that Daily Show viewers are more informed about the news than most cable news networks.
Absolutely.
News,
and the thing you guys were talking about, the concerted effort to fund all of this stuff, all you have to do is watch the RNC. and the speeches that were given. I was watching Rudy Giuliani. I was like, oh my God, we're gonna die. I mean, he was so passionate about these, and I was like, half of me was scared and half of me was cracking up. But it was every one of them that came up was like, or even when you watch, there was one of the debates where all the Republican candidates, like there was like 12 or 15, I don't know which one it was, every one of them was like, you know, ISIS is bad, I'm gonna get ISIS. And the next guy was like, well, you're not gonna, I'm gonna get ISIS in a headlock, I'm gonna get him in a headlock, punch him. And the other one was like, I'm gonna blow him to smithereens. And they were just going down the line trying to tell us how bad ISIS is. And I was like, no one's at home going like, no, ISIS is good, you know? But they were so trying to be the cowboy, the tough guy. And it was this thing, if you watch that debate, you leave going like, oh my God, I'm gonna lock my door. Anyone that's brown, I'm not gonna get close to because they could be ISIS.
But let me ask you this. You mentioned kind of the Republican debate, and it's very easy to go off to kind of the orangutan and the rest of the party. And we've talked about the right, the far right, et cetera. But just on the liberal side of things, I mean, you said you're a liberal, you work in Hollywood in California. I mean, you look at something like Time Magazine, yeah. Very liberal publication, ran a piece last year, I think it was, by Michael Oren, former US ambassador to Israel, which is all about the Iran deal. And his whole analogy for the whole piece was, negotiating with Iran over nuclears is like going to a carpet merchant yeah. and buying a rug from an Iranian bazaar. And just like they lie to you in the bazaar, they're lying to us. You know, it's kind of lazy orientalist yeah. tropes. When you see stuff like that in kind of respectable, supposedly respectable liberal publications, you think, wow, there's a long way to go to kind of overcome stereotypes about Iranians, Arabs, and the rest.
Absolutely. I mean, listen, I come from it from the angle of what you just said. I'm an actor, I'm a comedian, I'm in Hollywood, and I feel that, you know, you look at other communities, whether it's the African-American community, Latino community, Asian community, they have made progress through time, and eventually it becomes where, for example, we all know that, you know, most of the parts that are out there for Middle Eastern actors are the negative, the bad guy. And that used to be that the only parts for African-Americans were the pimp and the drug dealer. And now you've got, you know, Denzel maybe playing a cop or although he ended up being a bad cop in Training Day. Anyway, the point is that eventually you start to normalize it where when they're looking at casting and it's written for a cop, they go, well, we can see Denzel, we could see, you know, Navid Nagapan or whoever the person is. Once we get there, and so what I'm getting at is, you're right, it's still okay, even from the left, it's still like accepted to say things like that, but
is
hopefully
that, it won't. Is that your experience?
Yeah, well, I mean, my experience has been, you know, ridiculous. Like, I went in for a part once where they, I was asked to be clapping in the background of a casino table, and I got a callback, not to brag, for this part. And at the callback, the casting director said, "Oh, Negin, like you're so great." And I was like, "I know, I'm like really excellent at clapping." And she said, "But if we gave you this, you know, you're too ethnic for this part, and if we went that route, you're not ethnic enough." So there's this interesting thing that they expect an Iranian, I don't know, to look, I don't know what, but it's not me for whatever reason, even though full-blooded. Anyway, so, the interesting thing is too, like there's shows like Mr. Robot, right, where they hired Sunita Mani to play an Iranian, and I love Sunita Mani. She's in my last film, Third Street Blackout, available on Amazon, and she is. And what's interesting about her is that I'm not saying she's not Iranian, but I am saying she's definitely Indian. So why not have that part, you know, just be Indian? Why does she have to shoehorn herself into playing an Iranian?
Because
it doesn't make any sense.
Although to compensate, have you seen Night Of?
I was about to say
The father is Iranian, but plays Pakistani, which is just threw me.
So there's these ridiculous things. So we, even if we want to kind of, to Maz's point, like get ourselves into the mainstream, there's these roadblocks about like how
Let's
exactly.
Let's just be happy it's not Ben Kingsley anymore doing
right.
all this.
Yeah, true, I mean, there was true, a time true.
But listen, you know what?
I think really the best person to represent us is Gael Garcia Bernal. Yes. So as we all know from Rosewater. But I think there's an interesting thing that I think is maybe that happens with our community is that Iranians are, I'll just go ahead and say it, pretty rich. Y'all have money. And so I think with that comes a little bit of, you know, the people in this room are extremely connected and politically involved. But I think the average Iranian may just be like, I don't know. I have a Mercedes. Everything is fine. You know? And so, like, there's a little bit of, like, an, you know, I feel like there's sometimes I worry that that kind of success breeds complacency.
But even after 9/11, so after 9/11 in California, where famously hundreds of Iranian Americans were asked to come and register if they had entered the country before 2002 without the right visa, whatever it was, and then they were detained and arrested at the time. And you'd think, you know, God forbid there's another major domestic attack, you know, a Paris version in the US, what will happen to various communities? It's going to be the Arab communities, Pakistani communities, Iranian communities are hit first. Mm-hmm. And you know, the fact that Iranians are going to say, we're not part of ISIS or Al-Qaeda, is not really going to help those Iranian Americans.
They're Shia or Sunni, it doesn't matter. Well, to your point, we as successful individuals, as a community, we come together exactly like all other groups organize. And I think the most successful, and we are in Washington, the biggest lobbyists in this country are, the most successful ones have been two for the last 30 years, maybe. I think the Israeli lobby, AIPAC, and I would say the Saudi lobby, whether we don't, even if we don't see them. And those are the people who are fomenting hate and spewing hate against all of you. I remember, you know, to your point, after the Republican convention, my aunt, who's 70 years old, was sitting in Haifa. She watched it. She called me. She said, I think you should get out of there before, sorry, my language, shit start hitting the fan. And she was concerned. Truly concerned. She's the same woman that called me 8 years ago and said, can you believe we have a black man in the White House? Our cousin is in the White House. I mean, this is the same woman in the span of 8 years. What I'm saying is people who lived in oppressive cultures understand what's about to come and see the signs. I'm telling you, I'm seeing all the signs. I've seen them in Bosnia. I've seen them even in the Middle East. And if you think that you are too successful and too far and it will never touch you, you are blind to it, maybe. You don't see it. Actually, it's coming, and it's okay. Coming, and it's very short.
I'm just going to go to Cyrus and then come back to Matt. Yeah. Cyrus, you're obviously running for lieutenant governor. You're in the state senate. You're the first and only, I believe, Iranian-American elected to a state position, a national position, so statewide position. But let me ask you this. We talked about casting. Obviously, in politics and public life is an important place for Muslim Americans, Iranian Americans, yeah. Arab Americans yeah. to get visibility. What are the roadblocks that you think need to be tackled from within the community to make that happen? You have people from outside, like Martin Kramer, a very famous right-wing pro-Israel academic, said a few years ago, you know, DC officials should be careful about having any Iranian Americans in government or near government because they can't be trusted. Mm. So, you know, that's what you're getting from outside. Right. What do you do inside?
So I want to answer that by kind of broadening it a little bit. Sorry to take over as moderator. It's what leaders do.
Please do.
No, but I want to ask this because there's something different to me about Middle Eastern Americans as an umbrella group, I'll say, including Iranian Americans, than other new American groups. And I think since just we're all among friends here and everyone watching, here's the thing. There are lots and lots of negative things said about Vladimir Putin on all the time. Like, and liberals say it, and conservatives say it, and people say it, like, all the time about the Russian government, about Russians, the Olympics there, and, you know, and similarly about the Chinese. And yet there seems to be, and you don't see Russian Americans or Chinese Americans, forming a kind of a NIAC equivalent, right? There's not like, I mean, maybe there are groups that say we should have stronger ties, but it's not, there's not the same type of fervor. And I think the reason is there's kind of a vicious cycle that that this type of ethnic bigotry leads to, which is that if it weren't for the fact that Iranian Americans were rounded up after 9/11, if it weren't for the fact that the Patriot Act had been passed, if it weren't for the fact that, you know, people here who are, you know, bona fide Americans were treated differently, then I think Iranian Americans and Middle Eastern Americans would undergo the same type of evolution, frankly, that other groups have had, where they kind of say, you know what, like I like Rumi, and you know, like sometimes I put on some, like, you know, some Dariush records to feel nostalgic, but like I don't really connect with the politics of Iran. It really doesn't bother me that much if America doesn't like the country of Iran, because I'm second or third generation American by this point. That hasn't happened. That level of kind of political assimilation and becoming American hasn't happened, in part because, largely I would say, because of the domestic policies that have not differentiated between The mullahs running Iran and Iranian Americans here who are running businesses and doing everything that Americans do. That, not to get to your question, is ultimately Japanese Americans run for office and are not tarred with World War II. Ultimately, Russian Americans run for office and aren't tarred with Vladimir Putin or the Soviet Union's history. It's a little bit more difficult right now because we are currently still in a situation where Iranian Americans feel very, very protective of the nation state of Iran, even though we may really, really dislike the regime there. That's very different than other communities, and I found that to be a challenge as an Iranian American candidate because I neither want to run on a kind of muscular foreign policy that I think doesn't work and would be bad for America. Laying aside bad for Iran, I think it's bad for America to go down the kind of neocon path. But I also find it very, very uncomfortable to find a language and to navigate this. And I think Iranian Americans then find it really unpleasant to run for office because rather than being asked about public schools or freeway funding or healthcare access or affordable housing, inevitably it comes around to like, well, what do you think about this foreign policy question?
Okay.
I put a lot out there, but
that's all very interesting. So on that note, I'm going to throw open. I'm going to throw it open to the audience on that note. And but before I do, two questions. One is to the panel, which is very quickly: yes or no? Do you think Donald Trump's going to be president?
No.
No.
Doesn't matter. His legacy is here to stay. Even if he doesn't win, his legacy is here to stay.
And you're not talking about the Reality Apprentice, Joe.
No.
Joking. Sadly. Schwarzenegger, apparently he can't go back to it. Schwarzenegger has the show now, so he's lost that as well.
Schwarzenegger's got the show?
Yeah.
Oh, good.
Celebrity Apprentice.
Oh, wow. All
Finally.
Right. I didn't know that they were casting that. Okay. I hope not. I she's scaring me, but I hope not.
Shaking you out of complacency.
Yeah, really hoping not.
And before I go to the audience, just we're talking about kind of phobias, Islamophobia, bigotry, discrimination, etc. And Negin put the controversial point out that some of you may be complacent, just out of interest, because I saw some polling done a few years ago that 50% of Iranian Americans say either them or someone in their family has experienced some form of discrimination. Who here in this room has experienced discrimination either because of their ethnicity or faith? Just out of interest. Okay.
Wow, that's
okay. That's a depressing verdict.
Well, you know, the thing,
70% of the room.
Real quickly, the thing that about what Negin and everybody was saying about Iranians getting involved, this group are the ones that are involved. I think that there's a lot that the unfortunate thing, kind
of
like what Cyrus was saying, some have not assimilated yet, and a lot probably come from, I think, the Iranian revolution, and there's just the way the politics work in Iran. A lot of Iranians are like, I want nothing to do with it. But hopefully future generations like you will start to.
Okay, I believe there's volunteers with microphones wandering around the tables. So if you stick your hand up, the lady there in the green, can we go to first?
Hi, my name is Layla Ogabian, and this question is for Cyrus specifically. How do you combat those questions of you having to represent the Iranian American community in the foreign policy perspective? How do you overcome that issue, the one you just spoke about?
Yeah, well, thankfully, it's not. It's not a question on the merits because I've been in the state legislature. I'm running for lieutenant governor, and at least for now, the lieutenant governor doesn't have a whole lot of say over foreign policy. Give me 4 years, we'll see what we can do. But when I'm asked the question, I always make it clear that I don't speak. There is no quote unquote Iranian American community to speak on behalf of, and even if there were, I've not been delegated, that authority. So I always speak for myself, and if I'm asked a question, and I've found ways to speak out, and I think it's important that you speak your mind even on issues that you don't oversee in your elected position. So, I did speak out against the visa waiver changes that we saw last year. I do support repealing those and making sure that Iranian Europeans can travel, and Iraqi Europeans for that matter, can travel to the United States, and so we don't imperil also our ability to travel overseas. I did speak out in support of the Iran deal. It's easier in my state, as it is for those of you who are from California. It's easier because You know, our politics are more liberal, and non-Iranian Americans also happen to agree with us in overwhelming numbers. But I would imagine if you're Iranian American and you want to run for office, you know, like in Florida, that could be very, very difficult and may prevent you from even wanting to run.
Okay. Just there at the back there at the table.
Hello, my name is Armin. I'm a law student from Norway.
Can you speak up a bit?
My name is Armin. I'm a law student from Norway. I came here for this conference, and my question is regarding something Cyrus brought up, and it wasn't really discussed much. And my question is, are we really discussing the symptom of bigger problem, namely the economic issues? I know Europe has its own problems, but here, really, the economic divide is much, much bigger. And are those things contributing to the rise of, for example, racism as we're seeing it now? Thank you.
Who wants to take that, Negin?
You know, one of the things that I feel like has really contributed to the rise of just bigotry generally is this kind of, for those of you who read Robert Putnam, you'll know what I talk, he's the Harvard guy that talks about social capital. He wrote this really wonderful book called Bowling Alone. And the idea is that, like, you know, he was sounding the bells, and when that book came out in like the early 2000s, that, you know, the social capital is disintegrating because we don't have, you know, bowling leagues anymore. We don't have the 4-H club, like these kinds of institutions that used to be the kind of civic heartbeat of communities. We don't have those anymore. And so, like, now I feel like it's even worse. So people kind of get into their fringe silos and then start developing their own crazy ideas. And then I think, you know, and that kind of leads to more violence and leads to more just general,
and of course,
generalized
hate. You say silos, you can't miss out on social media, which of course has has given this stuff a huge boost.
So I feel like part of the thing that is so, I'm about to say something that's so ridiculous and might seem reductionist, but I think one of the best things that we can do to sort of combat racism and bigotry is literally make a friend. Make a friend from the other side of town, from the other side of the tracks, from the other side of your, you know, social and economic class. Because if you make a friend, if you share a cupcake or a beer, or, you know, like go on a date and hopefully make 1,000 babies, that's when you'll see, I think, like when a community gets really built, you know, is through those kind of personal interactions.
If I may, it's, I think there's a sense of humiliation also, national sense of humiliation. Look, 2000, the war on terror was supposed to last a couple of months, $2 billion, and it's over, $1 trillion. It was lost in Iraq and elsewhere. Let's be clear about that. People died in America, 5,000, I think soldiers died, and thousands. But then you had the 2008 crash. One out of five Americans lost their home. I think millions lost their jobs. And the other side, both sides, really didn't do much to somehow rebalance that moment. And it was a national trauma, real national trauma. Then you add to that Katrina, where suddenly the government is nowhere to be seen. So all of this added up. And sadly, it's what Bernie Sanders was pointing out, and it keeps his message keep being ignored by even the Democrats, that there's this seated anxiety, whether it's for your security, safety as a human being, and also for the future of your children. And there's this sense of humiliation and being ignored. It's a vote of defiance. Brexit was sending a message, basically, a protest vote. If you look at Germany, they just had the election in Berlin. For the first time, you might have a fascist party in Germany. For the first time. Look at the data, look at the trends all over the Western world. Suddenly, in the Netherlands, Hungary, you have Orbán. You have Madame Le Pen that is seen to win the election in France, one of the most important countries in Europe. Matteo Salvini in Italy, and you name it. So the trend is in that direction. And I think we need to challenge also the Democrat to do something about equality, social justice, and the economics, because if Hillary keeps ignoring these signs, we will get hit. It might be not now, but in 4 years.
Okay, let's go back to the audience. Lady here's waiting.
I wanted to go back to the brown and the non-brown issue and the us versus the them. I've lived in this country for about 40 years. I was talking to an American friend of mine, dear friend, who's we've been friends for 20 years, and we were talking about these, and she told me that, well, she's white and I'm brown. And I said, whoa, first of all, thank you so much for, if it weren't for you Americans, we wouldn't know what we are, which thank you for defining us. It's a good thing after all this time that I know that I'm brown, but I don't think of myself as brown. I actually didn't think of myself as any particular color. It depends where you are from Iran. If you're from the south, you're gonna be more brown. If you go further to the north, you're gonna be more white. So no, you're clearly brown. I'm like, okay, fine. And then the following week, I was talking to another dear friend, African-American, also my college friend from a long time ago, and I said, can you believe it? I was talking to so-and-so. She tells me that I'm brown and I'm not white. And she said, you think that you are white? I said, yeah, I thought that I was white. Why? He said, well, you'd better not be white, because if you are white, that means you're with them, you're not with us. Okay, so then there is something really horrible happening, which is it's new and it's and. But what is alarming me more is that for the first time I see the same labels being applied by ourselves. Like we are, as some sort of a pushback against that, and to say that we're in solidarity, we are now starting to use that term as well, us brown people. And I think that there is a danger in doing that because we are assuming and integrating and assimilating the labels that are kind of like imposed to us as a pushback, but I don't think it's a good thing. And we should push back on those labels. And
I agree with you. I actually agree with you. And I think when I talked about Browns and us and versus them, that was the division that was made. But I think it's a division that was made in this country from the beginning. Superiors, inferior, human, subhuman. This was a division in this country. When people criticize my work, saying that I am motivated by my gender or my ethnicity or by my religion, well, they have to tell me which identity because I wear so many hats and so many things. But the burden of proof fall on them, not on me. But as communities, and I'm talking about oppressed communities and as minorities, coming together, it's not because of our skin, because of the threat that is we are about to face. Coming together, it's not because I'm brown and he's less brown and he's more a little brown. Bit more brown. It doesn't matter. My daughter is as white as the walls of whatever. However, my mother was browner and my father dark. Didn't matter. What matter is, it's like in a marriage. It's not you looking at me and me looking at you. It's looking in the same direction. And the direction we will have to stop is this flood of neo-fascism that is arriving in America.
But I also think, listen, it's you can educate people, but you can also use it to your advantage. So, for example, I hate it when someone says, when they introduce me to somebody, go, oh, he's a Persian comedian. I'm like, no, I'm a comedian that happens to be Iranian, but, you know, I go to the comedy clubs and there's all different ethnicities, and I'm not just a Persian comedian. I don't like that label. But that said, you know, if I have a white friend that's hanging out with a bunch of Persians, I might say, like, hey, man, you're about to get some flavor tonight, you know? So the idea being, the idea being like, yeah, you are about to get infused with what I consider, even though Iranians are ethnically white, I consider us, like, we get put in that brown category. So I kind of embrace it sometimes. I named one of my specials Brown and Friendly because I wanted to show that it's not just me, it's Iranians, it's Arabs, it's Indians, it's Pakistani, it's even Latinos, it's all the others who, by the way, there's a lot of white people who are friends and embrace these people, but there's a lot of white people who go, that's the enemy. So I wanted to say, no, we're brown and friendly. So I use that as a way of being like, you're gonna give me a label, I'll take that label and I'll push back with a positive. So when your friend says you're brown, I would hug her and be like, fantastic, you know, and we can all get along and let's just move on.
I mean, it's funny though, I some of it I think is a little bit generational too, because, you know, they mentioned my book, How to Make White People Laugh, available on Amazon and wherever fine books are sold. And when I gave the book to my parents or whatever, they were like, they didn't understand the title of the book because they were like, but you are also white people, you know? And I was like, I'm not white, what? And it literally never occurred to me that my parents didn't think that they were brown. And I have never thought of myself as white, ever, never. And so I was like, this is crazy, you know? And I was like, no, we need to sit, you guys need to sit down. I'm gonna tell you what you are, you know? But you know, so it's, I think part of it too is sort of like how you come up, and around, you know, in what situations. Because like I grew up in a town where it was like a majority Mexican, and I felt more Mexican than I did anything else, you know? So
it's also the point you made earlier that bigots don't do nuance.
They don't care.
And I think we can get wrapped up in this, but you know, focus on who the opponents are. You know, when your local Trump resident brown shirt comes to take you to the camp, yeah. he's not going to check your beliefs. He's not going to check what you're... He's not going to have some color-coded bar chart.
he might. It
won't matter. We're all going to be
screwed. By the way, my driver bringing me here, who was from, he was a Serbian, and he asked me, so all these people are gathered in a bunch of brown people. What are you talking about? I said, well, we're all Trump supporter. I was sarcastic, obviously. He looked at me, he said, me too, and I'm from Serbia, and we really taught them a lesson. Oh, I froze in the back seat, and I thought, wow, that's amazing. And I asked him, I said, you know, I'm a Muslim woman. I happen to be a Muslim woman. You have Muslim friends. He said, yeah, my neighbor. And the conversation ended there. So what I'm trying to say is even simple people that we don't think of, they can't really turn against us, exactly like it happened in Serbia.
I hope you didn't give him 5-star on the
Brown.
Uber rating.
The thing about Twitter, Brown, can I say something
yes,
about Brown?
Yes, Cyrus.
So I also think there's a power in it in that this country will be all Brown. Right. I mean, yes. If all goes as planned, right? like this is like no seriously, like, and this is the point is that like this is what. So there's so many things about Obama. There's so many things about Obama that are so powerful in who he is, and I think we're just now, and I think for years we will continue to understand what he does to just in who he is as a traditional essence of identity. One. He is the embodiment of a certain type of globalized world, right? Kenya, Indonesia, America. Two, he is biracial. Three, he has you know access to all different and respect for all different types of religious practices and experiences. Four, he's the child of an immigrant. So he has the immigrant experience as well, although you know a temporary immigrant. So the thing about Brown is that you know what happened with President Obama's parents is just going to keep happening, and that's a good thing,
but
there will be a Brownification of this country.
But haven't you, with those 2 points, put your finger on slightly undermined what you yourself said earlier about it being economic anxiety? Isn't it really about the fact that there are a bunch of people in this country who don't like the fact it's not going to be a white majority country anymore, and they don't like the idea of a black president?
This started in 2008. Don't clap for me contradicting myself. No, but I say that I think there is a connection. The two are not separated. So if you are, what do they fear about globalization? What do they fear about immigration? They fear that their jobs.
True,
are
but there's also a lot of wealthy white Republicans who don't like the fact there's a black president. Regardless of globalization or free trade.
I don't think that. I would say they don't like that there's a Democratic president. Okay. I think there's a whole mix of
things. We're running out of time, so we're going to go back to the audience. I'm going to take 3 questions at once. Trita here, lady here, and in the corner, lady there. Go, starting here.
Thank you so much, and thank you guys for a fantastic panel. I'm very pleased with what you guys have been saying, and I think it's absolutely correct, particularly pointing out that this type of xenophobia that currently is manifesting itself as Islamophobia eventually will reach our community as well. But I think it's also important to point out that that should not necessarily be the reason as to why our community also needs to step up and help push back against racism. Take the example of the Sikh community. The Sikh community were the ones that were targeted the most after 9/11 for a very simple reason. It's very easily discernible that someone is Sikh because they wear a turban. Now, they happen not to be Muslims. And in the beginning, they did exactly what the Iranian-American community did. They tried to distance themselves from it and point out to everyone that they're not Muslims. Eventually, they realized that doesn't work. And beyond that, it's wrong. They have to stand up against racism and the xenophobia, even if it won't come to them at any point, simply because that's a value that they have to uphold.
Thank you.
If you haven't watched Hasan Minhaj's item on Sikh Americans Islamophobia, please do watch it on YouTube.
We actually bought tickets to Hasan Minhaj's show here in D.C. In December. My name is Marsha. I am the proud mother of 2 brown babies. My husband's African American and I'm Iranian.
I was born in the U.S. and I'm contributing to the brown cause. Now, my question here is, in terms of inspiring the next generation, our children are growing up and forming certain or shaping certain narratives on what they see in on TV and the movies and the media and the news. How can we encourage them both in our own narrative within our communities? Because oftentimes our parents and grandparents are still living in the white or non-brown or et cetera world. How can we inspire them to contribute more in journalistic, producer, script writing, other endeavors that are maybe not traditional in our communities so that they can help own and shape the narrative, policy, political leadership? It's just not, it's not something that's ingrained in our immigrant community minds. And I feel like our children need to start to step up, because if you ask my daughter right now, she literally sees herself as a global citizen. She's not caught up in the black, white, brown. She's like, I am here to support the human race. I am here, I don't, she's blind to the color. Yet how can we inspire them to start to contribute career and academically to help shape the narrative of the next generation?
Okay, great, well put. In there in the corner.
This question is for Maz Jobrani. I'm wondering what...
you can put the microphone a bit close to your mouth.
What American Indian think about immigration status of Donald Trump?
Indian Americans? That's my wife's Indian American, yeah. What's that?
I think he's being Native Americans.
What do Native Americans think about Donald Trump?
Yeah, immigration.
You're
status.
You're asking me about, oh, about his status. Well, I'm guessing they don't like it that he was that he came. What German. Is his? What is he German?
German and
his grandparents
Scottish.
Are German.
Yes,
German and Scottish. I think on Monday it would be, wouldn't it be great if in the debate it came out that he was born in Kenya? Yeah. That would be cool. Yeah. I'll start your and then I'm sure everyone's got. Listen, my parents wanted me to be a lawyer or a doctor, and I love the fact that this generation is telling their kids do what you love. I'm seeing more and more young people in film and television and stand-up comedy. It is so encouraging, and I think that inevitably it helps us, whatever their passion is. And I feel like a citizen of the world as well, because I feel like I've performed all over the world. And if I've performed in Saudi Arabia, which is supposed to be Iran's enemy, and I go there with love, and I laugh with them, and it's all Saudis in the audience, and we're laughing
maybe
together.
Maybe they thought you were a white guy.
Maybe they thought I was a white guy. Yeah, it all goes well until I go, so I was born in Iran, and they go, what? So I am a citizen of the world as well, but that's because of what I chose to do. So whatever they love doing, encourage them to do it. And I think that we're a generation of parents that can do that. I'm doing that with my kids every day. They're 5 and 8, and I tell them, find what you love. And if that's something that's in the entertainment world or journalistic world, well, then welcome. We will welcome you with Rula. Open arms.
It's amazing, actually, to see your daughter. I was looking at her, and she looks a lot like my daughter, who was born in Italy and whose father Italian. We all raise our children on universal values. Regardless your ethnicity, this is the American dream. This is what Martin Luther King wanted for all of us, for all of our children. It's like, regardless your ethnicity of religion, you belong, you know, you're a citizen of the world. This is the 21st century. And I am in the media, and I'm obviously very frustrated with the media work. And since here we have very, you know, prominent individuals and part of the community, please send emails and push back as much as you can. Organize, open websites, maybe production companies. And I'm horrified when I watch some, you know, to relax my brain, I watch cartoons. Because if I watch any of the TV series, I get so upset. I don't know if you watch Tyrant, for example, or Homeland. The racist, excuse my language, shit that they put out there is, the stereotyping is pumped to the... And they have never been a writer, screenwriter. When I wrote Miral, my own movie, that was unprecedented. And still, I would get phone calls like, well, you can't say that because they will not accept. It doesn't matter. Just push, push, and push.
Well said.
Uh, I mean, I would say I'm really lucky because my brother is 13 years older than me, and he became a doctor. And then he was, so that sort of took care of that. But he also became someone that doesn't like being a doctor. So my parents are like, ugh, he's unhappy with it. That's a drag. And so they realize that, like, just having a doctor as a child isn't enough. They also have to be happy. And so when I went and did all of my things, they were like, great, you know, so that worked out. They're also super weird. But I think the other thing is that, we don't have a pipeline. Like, we aren't necessarily, like, plugged into the systems by which Hollywood makes things. And so, I think one of the things, and people say this a lot, but I'll just say it again, is you vote with your dollars and support all the movies and the books that have been made by the people on this panel. But, you know, because that's how we can prove that there's value. And then the one other thing I was going to mention was that, you know, in terms of fighting the fight and being really intersectional about it, I think, you know, we're not only fighting against the bigotry that's occurring to other ethnic groups and minority groups, but, you know, I think it's really important. It's much harder for us to kind of get on board with the LGBTQ fight, but it's really important for us too. And I think the thing that's really hopeful for me is to see this fight in the eyes of my parents. One of my childhood best friends came out of the closet, and at first they were like, oh, but he was such a handsome boy, you know? So it went from, like, this disappointment into, you know, cut to, like, 6 years later, and they're like, oh, Negin, have you found him boyfriend? He shouldn't be alone. Look at what a handsome boy. And so now they're, like, trying to pimp him out to other men. And that is so, I mean, it warms the cockles of my heart that my parents have become pimps to gay men. And so that's, you know, we can do that. Like, we have the capacity to feel that way, and I think that's really hopeful.
Cyrus.
Yeah, I think I don't even remember what the questions were anymore, but I will say that, I'll say that I'm a politician, always happy to talk. I'll say this, I think that what these three fellow panelists of mine have been doing lays the groundwork for more people running for office. And I really mean that. It's not the other way around. And the politics will come, but they will probably come last. And that's unfortunate. And that being said, if there are people here who are interested in running for office, or you know someone who's Iranian-American, I feel it's a responsibility and a pleasure to mentor people and to be a resource to anyone who's Iranian American wants to do that. Even if you're Republican, I'll try to convert you, but even if you're Republican, I'll kind of connect you to somebody. But the culture needs to be part of it. And I think what's so important about people who are comics and comedians is that, you know, a lot of times the rap on Middle Eastern Americans, which used to be kind of the rap on and still somewhat is on black men, is that, like, we're just very angry and very intense and very bitter. And, you know, these are just broad cultural stereotypes, of course, but there's, you know, they're different than what people think about, you know, model minorities like Asian Americans, right? Or even Latinos. It is so important that the cultural and social commentary that we do be done in a way that works through the American consciousness and system, in a way that doesn't attack but allows people to come to their own conclusions. And they will. I really do believe that when Americans are shown the ridiculousness of some of the bigoted views out there, when it is satirized and in a smart and interesting way, people get it. And our country makes the right choices. And as that starts to happen, what people think and associate with the term Iranian or Muslim will also change. That will lead the way to more political power for all of us, so that we can avoid the types of bad policies that others want to impose.
And with those wise words, I'm going to wrap it up. So I'm going to ask you for one more round of applause for a fantastic panel.
Thank you.
Who gave us wit and wisdom. Thank you.
I want to thank Mehdi, actually.
I want to
thank our moderator.
Oh,
they've been
you.
Doing an amazing job
thank
all
you very
along.
Much.
Not
it.
Only here,
thank you so much.
But in challenging Islamophobes, racist, bigoted, and he's. I wish he is moderating one of these presidential debates. He would really make him red. Thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate it.